Subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
The COVID crisis is one that we are continuing to fight. And not just us, but the frontline corona warriors are the ones that we must appreciate at this point in time. However, what we are seeing is several cases of stigmatization, and we have eminent panelists today here with us to talk about, as Member of Parliament, what they're seeing, what they're hearing on stigmatization, and most importantly, how to combat stigmatization today as the number of patients increase and as COVID continues to remain a problem. In lieu of that, let me take a minute to introduce our eminent panelists today. We have three panelists. Let me start with Dr. Hina Gavit. Dr. Hina Gavit is Lok Sabha member from Nandurbar in Maharashtra from BJP. She's been working tirelessly towards combating social health issues such as malnutrition and anemia against women. Dr. Hina Gavit is currently a member of Lok Sabha from Maharashtra. Thank you, ma'am, for joining us today. We have Ms. Sunita Duggal. She is a former IRS officer and has made significant contributions in the service of the nation through her untiring efforts in the Income Tax Department. Ms. Sunita Duggal is now a member of Lok Sabha from Sirsa in Haryana. She champions the cause of women and youth empowerment and continues to work towards gender equality. Thank you so much for joining us, Ms. Duggal.
Thank you. Thank you.
And we have Mr. Krishna Lavu. Mr. Krishna Lavu is a member of the Lok Sabha from Narsaropet in Andhra Pradesh. He has spoken on a range of very pressing issues in the parliament, including women's rights, accessible healthcare services, and higher education. Thank you so much for joining us, Mr. Lavu, today. With that, I'll move on to Mohana to take forward the panel discussion this afternoon.
Thank you, Ritika. And I extend my welcome to all the panelists today. We are living in unprecedented times, and this pandemic is not something that any of us had imagined. We've been locked in our houses for weeks, and over a lakh people have been infected. Travel has been banned across the world. But the ones who are at the forefront of this fight, it's the essential service providers, especially the healthcare workers who are on ground, and round the clock, they are working relentlessly to save lives. But unfortunately, they have become the most vulnerable victims of stigma, which needs to be addressed. So that is what we are here to address today. That is how to combat this growing stigma of COVID-19. How do we battle the fear that has gripped all the people, which has made them behave unreasonably. So coming to Dr. Hina Gavit first, you are a doctor by profession yourself. We saw reports of doctors and nurses and others involved in essential services being asked to vacate their rented homes and being forcefully evicted. Of course, the Epidemic Disease Act has also been amended to make any form of violence and harassment punishable. So I would like to hear your perspective on this.
Fortunate that we hear cases of eviction of doctors and nurses from their homes. Actually, like you said, that we all had never imagined that we would come in a situation like this. But at the same time, we also have to understand the fact that these are the only people who can save us from corona. And having considered the kind of spread that is happening day in and day out, unfortunately, there's a lot of overloading of information through social media. There are so many myths. Now, there are thousands of messages coming in every day on the social media groups, and we never know. I mean, nobody goes in the background to check whether it's correct or it's false. And I think this is one reason that has kind of created a panic amongst the people. They feel that, oh, somebody who is a frontline worker and is in close contact with COVID patient, he might have contracted infection and that might spread. So I think we really need to create an awareness in the society so that we can also, you know, at the same time taking precautions. There's a very thin line between getting panic and taking precautions. So I feel that we need to create that awareness. We must tell people to take precautions, not that somebody who's working in the healthcare field is getting corona infected. If that person is taking proper care, proper precautions, there is no chance of that person getting infected. And we have example of lakhs of doctors and nurses in our country who are working in the hospitals, who are treating the corona patients and are not getting infected. So
of course, you also have some personal experiences with, you know, your own family and your own friends who are in the profession. So let us hear a bit about that.
In my family, I have my cousin who's a physician and who's the in charge of the COVID ward in my district hospital in Nandurbar. And I have been seeing him and his family very closely over these last 2 months, ever since the COVID pandemic has started. So he has to keep a safe distance from his family member, from his wife, from his kids. Since he works in the COVID ward, so while they are treating the patients, they also have to stay away from those people with whom they are emotionally connected. So it's definitely a big emotional issue as well. And I think at this point of time, we all must support the corona warriors, not just my cousin, but I have been seeing all those people who are working in the field. When they go back home, they are scared to go close to their kids, close to the older ones, because obviously everybody's taking that precaution. And I think this is a time where we should emotionally support all these people and not discriminate between them.
Right, absolutely. So coming to you, Ms. Sunita Dugal, we have seen a lot of reports of how the RWAs, the Resident Welfare Associations, have played a key role in ensuring, you know, all the rules are being followed within the society. The society is being, you know, barricaded from outsiders. But do you think that the overzealous behavior of some of these representatives turned some sections of the societies into, you know, vigilantes, which is why we saw these kind of behaviors?
Actually, you know, there are so many cases also, we should try to emphasize on them, who are welcoming them in case if the, I mean, this paramedical staff or the police personnel or this doctors, they come to their society after a gap of a week or so after their duty. And they all, you know, clap for them and they just put garland on them and they just put petals on them. So in case, like we should emphasize that there are so many cases of this type also. So, and as I'm 100% agree with the Hina, as she is saying, we should try to, you know, just make them just try to allay the anxiety. How we can just make them like it's not only one out of six that seriously sick, and that can be cured even. So the thing is, we should try to emphasize that the cure, the persons who are get cured are much more than the get sick. So I think these things are important so that we can just get them aware. Only then they can think in case like otherwise they just think that like if doctors, they are, most vulnerable, you can say, for the COVID-19. And that's why they just try to make distance from them. Mm-hmm. So in case if we just try to just, absolutely right. Hina is absolutely right. There is a thin line between the precaution and just you get scared of that you will get infected. So in case if we just emphasize on these things, then only we can try to improve the things.
Right. So coming to you, Mr. Krishna Lahu. So, you know, at the beginning of this pandemic, we saw whatever knowledge we got about the pandemic, whatever news we got was from the Western countries. And what we saw there was quite scary. And so do you think that the kind of messaging that came from those countries actually enhanced or, you know, increased the kind of fear that people here are facing? They do not want to be in the same situation. And there is also a little lack of trust on how well the healthcare workers are protected. So what in your experience is making people so scared and why are they behaving this way?
With respect to what the message that came from the West, the most developed countries, even the UK and US, what we have seen was the medical care personnel not having the right equipment, and they're also coming in the media, and they're also making comment that we're not having the right equipment to actually go and treat these patients. Once we saw that, the message coming across, the situation in India is close to that or even worse than that. because we also don't have the equipment, and most of that, more than that, not having equipment, we don't have the number of doctors. If you look at the 1:1,000 for population, we have one of the least across the world. So when we saw what the message is coming across the world, if we imagine the same number of patients going into the hospitals, I'm sure our health infrastructure would have literally collapsed. Luckily our, maybe because of our immunity, or maybe because the spread has not started, because we had a lockdown much in advance stage rather than at a very late stage. So the spread has not actually happened. Maybe it might happen once the lockdown gets lifted. Then we have to see how the medical personnel will handle the load. Yes, we needed that message coming across, and based on that message, our government has acted in a very even if it's a harsh way. Yes, we are acting in the right way, but there are people who have suffered with the measure of the lockdown, which we have seen, which we are seeing every day when we see so many people walking on the road to reach their destinations. Yes, people have suffered a lot. Lockdown has helped people who are middle class, above middle class, and up and above, but not to the people in the lower class. So the message we have taken from the West, yes, we've taken the harsh decisions based on the message, but it has affected people in two or three different ways, not in a single way. Coming to the medical personnel, yes, whatever Hina was saying was pretty much, I think, because of my wife being a doctor, she was not able to go to the hospital first thing, and they don't have the equipment to actually go and service the people there. One of the initiative that we have in Andhra Pradesh is village volunteers. Every 100 households have one volunteer, so volunteer goes to every household to deliver whatever the promises given by the government to the every household. So in one of my constancy, there were 6 volunteers in the small town of 1 lakh population. There were 6 volunteers who has contacted COVID virus. Mm-hmm. So when we see that, they are the people who are actually putting themselves out, who are actually reaching out to every household, who are actually taking out the a survey whether someone has a fever, whether someone has traveled from somewhere, whether all these surveys. We put them at the front line, doctors, these volunteers, police. I'm sure police have got so much of a bad press because of they were put in that stress, but they have acted. 90% of them acted very well, but because of 9-10% of them, they got bad press. So my feeling is, all these people, these are healthcare personnel, police, or all the municipality people, I think, because of the COVID situation, we started appreciating them more, the contribution that they are making to the society more. So I think going forward, we have the same opinion, and we try to build upon the facilities that we can provide to these people.
Right. So going back to Dr. Gawit, we actually have experience in combating stigma where diseases are concerned. I remind you of the time when we had sustained campaigns on HIV/AIDS. We had the tagline that was "Chune se nahi phailta," and that became a punchline in many movies. But the point is that it drove in the point. People understood because a local language was used, I believe, or it was a long drawn out campaign. Which help people understand the disease and understand how to live with it. So do you think that is a lesson for us to fight the stigma in the current pandemic? Do you think that is how, what is the way forward in your opinion?
I completely agree with what you say. Because what happens, this stigma that we're talking about is created because people have a fear that if somebody gets corona, ultimately that person is going to die. So we have to, in the first place, tell people that this is a disease that can be treated if it's, in the early stages, if we, find the patient, if we start treatment at an earlier stage. And if there is a comorbid condition, definitely we have to take extra care and take extra precaution while treating. So we have to make this thing clear in the minds of the people that if you get corona, you're not going to die. There is a way you can get out of it. And I think this is the only way how, you know, we can stop this stigma. Like you gave an example of HIV when there was a fear about HIV that, don't go close to somebody who's an HIV infected person. But then later on, there was this campaign, ki chune se nahi phailta. Like that, we have to create awareness amongst people that in India, when we're talking about almost a lakh patient infected, we also have to speak of thousands of them who have got cured from this disease and are safely back home. So I think this is one way that, you know, we can stop the stigma and kind of create that awareness within the people. Now, I would like to just mention a small example from my constituency. We had 21 corona cases in my district. In my district, out of these 21 cases, two mortalities. In these two mortalities, one was an older lady which was 85 plus with a lot of other comorbid conditions, and unfortunately, she died. But there was this young boy who was 32 year old who died because of COVID. So tracing back his history, he came to the hospital when he was in very late stage. That is when he had developed multiple organ failure. He was in septicemia. He came to the hospital. When doctors started, digging into the history that why did he come so late? So there was this stigma that if he goes to the hospital and he tests positive for COVID, then all of a sudden the society will stop contact with him, his family, his close ones. Because of this stigma, he came late to the hospital and unfortunately at the age of 32, he died of COVID-19. So I think we need to create this awareness that if you have any of such symptoms, the first thing that you do, you go test yourself and get treated. And this we can do only with the support of the society when it is not stigmatizing these people who are coming COVID-19 positive. So I think this is the only way that, you know, we can have early detection and treatment, and at the same time, awareness.
So, you know, talking about early detection, we still have a policy of testing the symptomatic patients. That is one thing. Second is that, from personal experience, I had a lot of my colleagues going to hotspots to, report on this crisis. And I had this one colleague who was afraid that she might be sick because she was not feeling well. And she did not want to get isolated in a completely strange place, right? And these are the kind of fear. It's not just about death. I don't think it's just about what happens if I die. It is also that, okay, if I test positive, my entire business might get shut down for weeks to come. My office might get shut down. I wouldn't be allowed to go out to work. So these are also the kind of, the fears that people have. So in that case, I'll ask one of the other panelists to weigh in here. If we had a policy of maybe, testing more people, voluntarily testing so that they know that they don't have the disease, do you think that would help, understand that, I'm not sick, I can go back to work, and put everyone else around them at ease as well? Anyone, Mr.
Lavu,
if you
want. Yeah, we in Andhra Pradesh, that's what we are trying to do. We are doing one of the highest number of tests across India, second highest actually across India. That's what our Chief Minister said. Once we create that sort of confidence in the people, that's the only way we can start these businesses and make the people come out with confidence and start working. Because going forward, every country, if you have, just like how you have a visa, I'm sure going forward, every country will ask if you have to go travel, come with a certificate saying you're negative of this virus. How we go to Africa, you get a certificate with the yellow fever vaccination and everything. But I think it'll happen in the going forward. The same thing, it's going to happen with the software services industry as well here. Most of the software companies are asking for it because when they're asking their employees to come and work, they were saying, sir, we have people at home who are older, so we want to be sure that yes, we are negative, but we want to be sure that people we are working with are also negative. So if you have to infuse that sort of confidence in those employees, yes, the employers has to have this sort of rapid testing happening in conjunction with the state governments. That's the only way you can instill the confidence. Even if I have spoken to people who are in the food processing as well, they are saying the same thing. They have these women coming to work in each factory, like around 2,000 to 2,000 people, and people who are coming and working there. They're also asking for the same rapid testing things, so that rapid testing kits, so that they come in with confidence and work there. So going forward, yes, I think all the states in India will follow the same thing as what we are following in Andhra Pradesh, where we have, if you find one positive case anywhere, we want maximum number of tests happening in that community, so that to instill the confidence in the community that yes, this is not first thing is to instill confidence that this is not spread. Second thing is to identify the people who are affected and make sure that they get the right treatment.
Right. So we briefly talked about misinformation at the beginning of this discussion. It's known, a lot of studies have shown that misinformation actually spreads much faster than real information because it's designed to catch your eye, it's designed to catch your attention. And that, in a time like this, I think this is the first time we are in a global pandemic and information is traveling very fast. Everyone has access to smartphones, everyone has access to internet. But apart from that, there is also word of mouth that is, It's spreading really fast. We hear all kinds of bizarre things related to COVID that are not true. So how do you as parliamentarians, think that this can be combated? There is one section that thinks that we really need to increase our messaging in local languages. I mean, a lot of the conversations that happen are in English or in Hindi. In the beginning of the pandemic, we saw phrases like, social distancing, flattening the curve, breaking the chain. These are not words that the Indian population, the Indian masses really easily understand or identify with. So can you give some examples of how local languages or have worked better maybe, or how have you approached the whole public messaging?
I represent a tribal area. Mm-hmm. And we have a tribal local language, and not many people read Marathi newspapers or follow news channels. So what we do what I have done is I make short videos in the local language and we try to circulate it amongst the people. We have our party workers in every village. So we send this, share this video that is regarding what precautions they have to take, what they should do if they come across somebody who has fever, cough, those kind of symptoms, or somebody who's traveling from an area which is a hotspot, what precautions that person has to take or the villagers should take while dealing with these migrants who are coming from hotspots, like in Maharashtra, Mumbai, Pune has become a very big hotspot. Malegaon is a place very close from my constituency. So these videos I have made in the local tribal language, and that's what we are sharing it amongst our party workers to every village, and then they show it over their phone to the other villagers. So right. This is a way we're trying to spread the word amongst the people.
I think Ms. Dukkal also wanted to, add her comments here. So I would request you to unmute your mic before you speak, Ms. Dukkal. So, yeah.
I just want to add, yes, we should say that mask pehne se nahi hota hai. Like that's ki chune se nahi hota hai. We can say in that way that mask pehne se nahi hota hai. Mm-hmm. So Hina is right, and I just want to ask Hina, in case if you just share that video to us also, so that we can just make it in our language and we can spread it in our constituency also. And I'm lucky enough because my constituency is, there is no even a single mortality, cases there, as well as only few cases, 2, 3, 4 cases are there positive and they're also cured. So in that way, I can say sometimes it happens in case your place or your city or your constituency is a backward one, then that that makes you happy in other way around. No progress is there, but otherwise there is no corona. Is also corona is also not here. So in that way, I'm very lucky. Not even a single death is there in my constituency particularly.
But now that, the lockdown restrictions are being eased, so there will be a lot of travel. So what are the, you know, what is the kind of thinking that you have now?
So yes, you are right. As Hina was saying, this is a thin line between precaution and the fear. We have to, you know, get out of the fear from all those people, so that they can, in a comfortable way, they can lead their life, and they can think is a disease. They can think COVID-19 as a disease only. It's like a disease, and you have to get cured. In case if you just get, this disease, then you have to get cured. In case if we just, this fear is out of them, then they can lead a normal life.
Right. So, we keep talking about this thin line between the fear and panic. Let's say, when we are now opening up to, getting back to normal, and our new normal would be living with the virus. And so people need to remain cautious for their own safety. Right. And so how do we find that balance? How do we make sure that people take precautions and at the same time, do not start behaving irrationally, do not start harassing people who are ill or healthcare workers who are working in the forefront of this crisis? Mr. Lavu, if you want to give some comments on this.
I think we have seen before the lockdown has started, I've seen, at least I was traveling from Delhi and other places, there is some sort of awareness among all the at least eight travelers, and they were wearing, most of them are wearing masks, and some of them are wearing gloves. But now after the lockdown has started, people have really taken it up, and they're very cautious about how they interact with others and everything. The only issue is when the lockdown gets ended by the end of this month, we haven't seen much of it. Maybe in Maharashtra and few other places we have seen the community spread, but once the lockdown ends, there will be huge uprising of cases. We have to see how we deal with them when this cases goes up. Mainly, we've seen what happening in Dharavi, or even in my constituency in Nasrapeta. We have two wards which are having one of the highest number across India, almost 168 or 169 cases. So they're reported from those 2-3 wards where the community spread was there. Imagine that happening in a few other spots. So we have to take the message to those places, because as I told you earlier, middle class, above middle class, those people are, this lockdown has helped them. In a way, and they're comfortable in a way, but the people that are struggled and this lockdown has not helped the people who are in the lower middle class and the really poor people. For them, to take this message across to them, making sure that if someone get affected by the virus, to come and actually get treated, and not to create that sort of fear among the community. That is where the challenge is going forward in the next 1 month or 1.5 months, because let's not stigmatize it and push the people as Hina was saying, that one of the young guy didn't want to come and get treated because he was scared that he will be stigmatized. So that is where the challenge is. That is where we have to do the campaigns in the local languages. We have to reach out with the heart, not with the with force, to understand the people, to try to communicate to them in their local language. That is where the challenge is. Next 1 month, 1.5 months is where the challenge is.
Right. So I think, we are at the end of this discussion. We've run out of time. It was very, very interesting to hear from all of you. So while the lockdown restrictions have been eased, but the pandemic is not yet over. So remember, we have over 77,000 active cases as of today. Over 1 lakh people have already been confirmed cases. So the virus is still very much within our midst. We have to learn to live with it. So stay cautious, you know, stay safe, but also stay compassionate. You know, try not to stigmatize those who are suffering from the disease or those who are working to save lives. I think we will sign out now. Thank you so much for watching. Do leave your comments, your thoughts below in the comment section, and subscribe to our print channel to get regular updates on the coronavirus coverage. We have wonderful colleagues, wonderful reporters all over the country reporting from the ground on this crisis. Thank you.
Thank you.